Rick, thanks, and welcome everyone to NASCAR Nationwide Series final practice here at Chicagoland Speedway. As we saw during the Truck Series qualifying, it is chilly here. Feels a little bit like fall in Chicagoland with overcast skies. And as the cars get ready to roll here, it is 60 degrees. And you know what? It feels a lot cooler than that with 42% humidity, just a little bit of wind. And of course, it is cloudy, but there is no rain in the forecast. Hello, everybody. I'm John Roberts alongside of Larry McReynolds. Mr. Jeff Hammond will join us very shortly up here in the broadcast booth. But you know, Larry, the talk in NASCAR over the past couple of weeks has been around the Sprint Cup Series. Who's in the chase? Who's out of the chase? But here in the Nationwide Series, we have a very interesting battle for the championship. 16 points separate two very different drivers.
Yeah, and that has been sneaking up on us because these Nationwide guys, they only have 7 races to go, including a race here tomorrow at Chicagoland. And when you look at those 7 races, the top 2 in points separated by only 16 points. Ricky Stenhouse Jr. leading the points. Here was a driver that was benched roughly a year ago. He's come back this year. You can see it as he leads Elliott Sadler by 16 points. But Ricky Stenhouse Jr., he's won 2 races and trying to win that championship. But the tale of two tapes, Elliott Sadler, a driver that spent 8 or 9 years in Sprint Cup. He made the chase in 2004. He's back in the Nationwide Series. And now he's trying to win his championship. But the thing I love about it, JR, we will have a true NASCAR Nationwide Series champion this year.
Yeah, Larry, just to refresh the fans' minds, in the beginning of this year, NASCAR said, hey, look, we can't have guys running for championships in different series. You have to declare before the beginning of the year which series you want to run for the championship in. And Elliott Sadler got together with Kevin Harvick, decided they were going to go for this Nationwide Series championship, and it is great to see him competitive once again.
But I think the thing that's missing right now with Elliott Sadler and his two, even though they're only 16 points out, they still have not found victory lane in 2011. As I mentioned, Ricky Stenhouse Jr., he's become Mr. Iowa. He won both the Iowa races this year.
And Elliott said once he got out of that truck that he won in Pocono, how excited he was to win no matter what it was in, because he said it made himself believe that he could be victorious again, that he could go to victory lane and take the checkered flag.
But the thing he has been a model of consistency. 19 top 10 finishes this year. In fact, he has 6 consecutive top 10s, including that 6th place finish at Richmond last week.
And there we see 2 of the Roush Fenway Ford Mustangs out there on the track right now. Ricky Stenhouse Jr. on the top of the speed chart right now, but also on top of the points with Trevor Bayne in the 16 right behind him on the speed chart today. Now, Ricky, like you said, Larry, to expand on what you mentioned earlier, Ricky Stenhouse was struggling. He was wrecking a lot of race cars. And as Jack Roush has done in the past, he took the young man aside. He said, hey, look, we got to calm down. Takes him out of the car for a while. He got calmed down, got back in, and started really winning and running well.
Yeah, he even came back and won Rookie of the Year last year, and here he's trying to back that up with a championship in 2011.
Certainly one of the top contenders and one of the rising stars of NASCAR, as is Trevor Bayne in the number 16. He's one of 8 drivers doing double duty this weekend in the Cup Series and in the Truck Series, I'm sorry, as the Sprint Cup Series and the Nationwide Series as well.
Now, here's the man that's 3rd in points, but the problem, Reed Sorensen in his 32 car for Turner Motorsports, he's 45 points out. And when you look at the Nationwide Series having the same point system as Sprint Cup, that's roughly a full race out of the lead with 7 races to go.
And let us correct, Larry, we have 12 double-duty race car drivers in the Nationwide Series and the Cup Series. And right now, Reed Sorensen is 4th on the speed chart.
Reed has that one win at Road America back in June. 16 top 10 finishes, but he's had trouble. I believe this is Angela Cope in the 44 car.
It is.
Get it cranked up there. Get it cranked up.
So caution is on the speedway.
All right, did you hear anything?
And JR, she had only run 1 lap. We saw that 60 degrees. It almost makes me think she overestimated the grip that these tires would have, because when it's this cold, it takes especially when you're down on air pressure, it takes 2 or 3 laps to get some heat in them to gain some grip.
Usually when we came to this racetrack before, it was July and it was very hot on the surface. Now it is very cold. When we come back, we'll have Wendy Venturini and Randy Pemberton joining us from the garage. Stay with us, everybody, as Nationwide Series practice is just getting cranked up here on speed. Speed's presentation of NASCAR Nationwide Series practice from Chicagoland is brought to you by AutoZone. Parts are just part of what we do. Get in the zone, AutoZone. And by Acura, Acura Advance. Here in Chicagoland at Nationwide Series practice, no one is advancing on the racetrack right now because we are under caution. Larry McReynolds, let's take a look at what happened to Angela Cope in the 44.
Yeah, you'll see her right there at the bottom of the racetrack. I almost get a feeling that it was down on air pressure, like I mentioned, and maybe something bottom out right there, because the minute she got to the bottom of the racetrack and the car would have been in full travel right there, it's like it got loose, started wiggling, and just came around on her.
And race fans will recognize that last name of Cope, because that is she is the niece of 1990 Daytona 500 winner Derek Cope. Let's now go to the pits and check in with Randy Pemberton. Randy?
We began talking today about the weather and the temperature. You probably could not have a better day down here for these pit crews as well as the drivers. It has been really, really consistent. The temperature never got up above 60 degrees. It's currently about 55 or so right now. And what that enables these guys to do is really A-B some stuff. It allows them to put tires on the car and go out there and really check some stuff. That's because the track temperature has not gone up much. I did some impromptu polling here from some of these guys in the back half of the garage area, Stephen Wallace's team to be specific. And they said it has been absolutely perfect so far today. So it's given them a great opportunity to run tires and know what they need. Now, I know Angela Cope had that problem. She may very well have bottomed out. One thing that these guys have, they can go out on the racetrack, put a set of tires on, and know exactly that they have the same thing they had the last time they were out there, because the temperatures are identical. When you talk about tires here, a little bit different than the Cup Series, they get six sets. Now, when this is over towards the end of this practice session, they will turn a set in. Right here, this is Stephen Wallace's, all set to go. They're going to make a mock qualifying run at the end, very similar to what most of these teams will, and then they'll get another set for tomorrow's race. But that's pretty much it. But it's been very, very consistent, and nice cool temperatures for all these guys working on the cars too. Let's go over to Wendy Venturini.
Thank you, Randy. I am enjoying the cooler temps in my hometown this weekend, and here in the Nationwide side on my end of the garage area, I have Carl Edwards, who's been a busy man. He's been hopping back and forth from the Nationwide car to the Cup car, finished Cup practice, came back over here to the Nationwide side. I asked him how his car was this morning and what they were hoping to accomplish this afternoon, and his first response was, gosh, I don't even remember. That was so long ago. It was 11:30 Central Time when he got in the Nationwide car, the first practice session, and he only ran 9 laps. And he recalled through his memory after he thought for a second. He said, oh, wait, we were a little bit loose this morning. They were working on corner entry, and they were hoping to do more of the same in this practice session. So a guy like Carl is very busy hopping back and forth and getting your mind straight on what you want your car to do on this racetrack, guys.
Wendy, the good thing is that the way this schedule is laid out for someone like Carl Edwards is all the practice for both series is today. And then all Carl Edwards will have to do tomorrow, aside from running that 300-mile Nationwide Series race in this 60 car, the two qualifying sessions for the two series, Nationwide and Sprint Cup.
And one thing, Larry, we know how you like to keep your eye on the weather. We understand from the weatherman that this little blast of fall is going to go away, and it's going to be pretty much normal temperatures for this time of the year. We're going to heat up a little bit tomorrow.
Well, I think we're experiencing the same thing down in the Charlotte, North Carolina area where we live. A couple of 3 days of some cool temperatures, supposed to be back in the mid-80s by the first part of next week.
Another one of those double-duty drivers, this time in the number 22. And that is Brad Keselowski, one of our chasers in the Cup Series, but also a threat to win anytime he races on the Nationwide Series. And, of course, after the broken ankle he suffered in a practice crash, he was out of the Nationwide car for a while. And that really bode well for that team, Larry, they were able to win so many of the Cup races while he was out of the Nationwide race. And he finally went to Roger Penske and said, hey, look, I'm winning. Can I go back to the Nationwide car? And he said yes.
Well, I know the one thing that he's been on the mark with this 22 Nationwide Series car is qualifying, because in the last 5 races that he has attempted, he has sat on the front row for all 5 races, including 3 poles, which would include the pole at Richmond last week.
His best finish here was back in 2008. He finished 3rd in the Nationwide Series, so obviously knows how to get around here.
There's his crew chief, Todd Gordon. I talked to Todd a couple of weeks ago. Of course, Paul Wolf was his crew chief in the Nationwide Series last year when they won the championship. And Todd told me, he said, it's just taken me and Brad a little bit of time to get used to each other. The biggest thing we have going for us, which I think is the same thing going on in the Sprint Cup, is the second trip around to some racetracks.
Every time you come back around, it is always good to see that you can make improvements on that. And that's hopefully what a lot of teams are hoping to do.
Now, this is Ryan Truex in this 20 car for Joe Gibbs Racing, and he was the fastest in that practice earlier. Joey Logano, I know a lot of times will be in the 20 car, but Joey Logano is actually in the 18 car for Joe Gibbs Racing. Kyle Busch has elected not to run the Nationwide Series, but the big push from Joe Gibbs Racing is trying to get the 18 team to win this owner's championship, because if they can win it this year, and they have a pretty good lead right now, that would be four consecutive owner's championship for Joe Gibbs Racing. Here you see Joey Logano in the 18 car.
And boy, has Joey Logano done well over the years in these Nationwide Series cars, and there's no indication why he shouldn't do well again this weekend and help them get that owner's championship. And Larry, that's a unique thing to this Nationwide Series. So often the past couple of years, we've had different owner's championships the driver championships.
Well, and I think we can safely say we're going to have that again this year for a little bit different reasons, because we talked about the driver's championship that's going on with the drivers that signed up for Nationwide Series points, but the team pretty much still going after the owner's championship, because the 60 team that Carl Edwards runs for, they are second in the owner points right now.
And of course, drivers Joey Logano and Kyle Busch in that 18 are running for the championship in the Sprint Cup Series. Joey Logano is out of the chase, but Kyle Busch is in it with a shot at a championship. Got to take a break here from Chicagoland. We'll be back with more Nationwide Series practice in just a moment. Tomorrow, it's the final race of the season for the Rolex Sports Car Series, and it's down to a three-way, five-point battle for the GT Championship. This is going to be awesome. Don't miss the Rolex Sports Car Series finale from Mid-Ohio tomorrow at 3 p.m. Eastern Time, 12 noon Pacific, only on Speed. And we understand from a source close to the investigation that it is also cold at Mid-Ohio as well. Right now, Brad Keselowski in his Penske Dodge is leading the way on the speed chart, with the two guys going for the championship, Larry, Ricky Stenhouse and Elliott Sadler, in the second and the fourth position on the chart.
Yeah, and we saw Ryan Truex in that 20 car earlier. He was fastest in the first practice. Here's Brian Scott, the third Joe Gibbs Racing Nationwide Series car, trying to hang in the top 10 in points. He finished third here a year ago, and that's actually his best career finish in the Nationwide Series.
And we understand by way of Twitter that he will be back with Joe Gibbs Racing again next year.
Sam Hornish Jr. in the 12 car, chasing Ryan Truex in that 20 car. Now, Sam Hornish has no Nationwide Series starts here, but he's won in the Indy cars twice. In fact, this is where he sewed up a couple of his three championships in Indy car.
You know, when we asked Sam years ago what the difference was between an Indy car and a stock car, does anything translate over? It was very interesting, the analogy he gave. He said the difference between a Cup car or a Nationwide Series car and an Indy car and the downforce is that there's so much downforce in an Indy car that if you could make it run upside down, it would run upside down. The gravity is that much that it would hold it upside down. So the downforce is so much different that nothing really translates over, except for the fact that you're a guy who wants to go fast.
And you know where the racetrack is located.
Yeah, you can find
it. Indy car. Now here's Michael Annette in the 62 car right now. He's 24th quickest. Actually learned a little something as we got Kenny Wallace in the 09, who is slow down the back straightaway on the apron. Kenny is 21st quickest. He's run a total of 11 laps.
And this team has had a little bit of a technical difficulty lately, Larry. At Richmond, they were running in top 10, and they had some mechanical problems there. Let's go to Wendy Venturini for more.
Hey, Johnny, I'm just listening to Kenny on the radio right now. They are out of gas, and I heard Kenny just come over and say, I am not going to make it around. So they are sending, they're in communication with NASCAR already to get somebody out there and push him around. But out of gas for Kenny Wallace.
Well, that's much better than what it could have been.
Yes, it could have. That's an easy fix.
Yeah,
other than probably
fix.
NASCAR's not going to be real happy about having to throw the caution. But Kenny has run a total of 11 laps in this practice so far. Got a top five finish at Richmond last week, qualified and finished fifth.
and is also seventh in points for Kenny Wallace right now. So as we got Brad Keselowski leading the way, it's Ricky Stenhouse, Trevor Bayne, Elliott Sadler, and Reed Sorensen in the top 5 in Chicagoland. Tonight on Speed, tune in as the world's toughest truckers go wide open in the Windy City. Don't miss the NASCAR Camping World Truck Series live from Chicago tonight at 7:30 only on Speed. Welcome back, everyone, to Chicagoland Speedway. We are about midway through this practice, final practice of the day for the Nationwide Series. Let's now get some reports from the garage from Wendy Venturini and Randy Pemberton. Guys?
Thanks, Johnny. Elliott Sadler's in the garage with the window net up, and they have run two sets of runs out there in this practice session. He's fourth so far in the 7 laps that they have run, and Elliott most recently said he is really happy with the setup of his race car. But Ernie Cope, his crew chief, they just want to make sure that this setup is not going to fall off on a longer run. So you see Ernie going to the window to chat with Elliott. A lot of communication between drivers and crew chiefs are left off radio chatter to keep people like us out of the mix. Randy.
Yeah, a lot of radio chatter going on down here, though, in the garage here. Trevor Bayne just now pulling out. I just had an opportunity to speak with Chris Andrews, his crew chief. Trevor going out for the second time right now. He's got 10 laps on the board, third quick. Chris told me that the car is tight getting in, which is somewhat unusual. Tight getting in, but it really gets through the middle well, and it gets off well. So they're trying to work on that. They just changed both front shocks on Trevor Bayne's car. And let's not forget, last time he was here, Trevor Bayne had a heck of a run. Finished third. Matter of fact, guys, his best finish of the season. They certainly would like to capitalize on what they knew then, bring it to the table here, and kind of expand on it. And they're doing that so far today.
Randy, thank you. The Chris they were referring to was Chris Andrews, his crew chief, and also Bayne finished third here in June. One of three times he finished a career best of third. So obviously, Larry, this is a track that Trevor takes a liking to.
Now we're looking at Rocky Bayne, which is Trevor Bayne's dad, but actually, yeah, Chad Norris is now looking after that 16 car. Chad has been over there about a month with Trevor Bayne.
He's a veteran at the crew chief position and other positions within Roush Fenway Racing over the years. So. Looks like he should be a good matchup with Mr. Bayne.
Yeah, that's one thing that I did want to point out also is we talked about the race in June. Just like Sprint Cup, the Nationwide Series has come here once a year for 10 years, starting way back in 2001. But this year, because of some of the schedule realignment, the Nationwide Series, they will race here twice. We raced here back in June. Justin Allgaier won the race, and then they come again here as companions with the Sprint Cup Series.
And over those years, Larry, we're always used to coming here when the track temperature was very hot, the air temperature was hot, a little bit humid, and we also dodged some thunderstorms in the afternoon over the years.
That's Paul Menard in the 33 car, driving for Kevin Harvick Incorporated.
And finally, we can talk about Paul Menard this week for something other than what happened at Richmond.
And I sure am glad. They have wore that out. It wore me out about it. I walked in their garage area this morning just to see how things were going. And they said, no, we did not spin out on purpose. I said,
you didn't even have to ask,
don't even care.
Well, that is certainly an interesting thing that NASCAR is looking at on the Cup Series right now. But Paul Menard's worst finish in four starts in the Nationwide Series in 2011 is 6 at Watkins Glen. So when he does come down to the Nationwide Series, he certainly means business.
Yeah, set on the pole at Michigan back in June and finished 2nd in the spring Richmond race, driving for Kevin Harvick.
Good combination between KHI and Menard over the course of this season as he's piled in the 33 this week. And he finds himself 2nd on the speed chart right now, just behind Brad Keselowski after being out there for 12 laps. Jamie McMurray is behind the set of the wheel at 7 car this weekend.
Yeah, he's running about 3 or 4 races. In fact, this is the 2nd of 3 races that he'll drive this 7 car for JR Motorsports. His next race will be at Dover in 2 weeks. Ran really well in Atlanta a couple of weeks ago and cut a tire down late in the race. But he did finish 9th here a year ago driving for JR Motorsports.
And Larry, it's kind of one of the neat things about this series, the Nationwide Series. We see different drivers driving different cars. There's been so many different drivers just behind the wheel of this 7. And also 20 different drivers this year have made their first Nationwide Series start, have made their debut. So we're seeing a lot of fresh new faces. We're seeing a lot of very familiar faces coming over from Cup to drive these cars.
Well, we know certainly the 7 car has occupied Danica Patrick. In fact, in that June race I spoke about, she finished 10th in that 7 car. We know that she, this weekend, is in the IndyCar over in Motegi, Japan.
So she's busy as well, but she's going to be very busy in the NASCAR world next year. As she has announced, she will run a full Nationwide schedule and a limited Cup schedule as well. Got to take a quick break. We'll be back with more of the Nationwide Series final practice in a moment. Thanks, Adam. Look forward to seeing a lot more from the Speed Center throughout this weekend. Back here at NASCAR Nationwide Series final practice, we're about a half hour into a 1 hour and 15-minute session. Brad Keselowski has been leading the way pretty much the whole time. And Paul Menard, Ricky Stenhouse Jr., Carl Edwards, Trevor Bayne, and Elliott Sadler are up in your top 6. And, of course, as we mentioned at the top of the show, it is Stenhouse Jr. and Elliott Sadler that are separated by just 16 points in that title chase here at Nationwide. And now we want to welcome in one of the hardest-working men in television and NASCAR, Mr. Jeff Hammer. Jeff, how's it going, buddy?
John, I got to the track. I said, I'm at the wrong track.
I'm
at the wrong track.
You really did that early in coming to Chicago.
I did.
I do remember that.
I did.
That
was the first time I came here. I GPS. I put in Speedway, Chicago Speedway, and the thing took me downtown. not the old Soldier Field track, but there is a racetrack downtown.
The IndyCar ran there, I guess.
Exactly. Yeah. IndyCar did. Chicago Motor Speedway was, and Chip Ganassi used to own it, I think. So GPS had not got that fixed up at the time, but I wound up there and made it here. But today I was taking care of some other speed needs, and it put me up behind. I miss being up here with you guys. But right now we're watching our buddy Kenny Wallace, race car driver Kenny Wallace, who had a fantastic finish last weekend at Richmond.
You know the biggest adjustment they've made since he was last on the racetrack?
I'm going to turn his radio off.
Put fuel in it because he ran out of fuel a while ago.
About 11 laps out on the racetrack, they ran out of fuel, but they put more of that ethanol-based fuel back in Kenny's car, and he's back out running once again. And what a phenomenal story this has been this year. 7th in points, so many top 10 finishes along the way. Kenny Wallace is back competitive again.
But I think we should answer the question, why would you run out of fuel if you've only run 11 laps this practice? Scott Zipadelli, his crew chief, knows that this 200-lap, 300-mile race tomorrow could come down to fuel mileage. So how do you know exactly how much fuel that fuel cell picks up? When you run it out, you go to the fuel pumps, and that tells you to the tenth of a gallon how much you can pick up.
Crew chief, you hope.
You hope.
Because your race car driver behind that wheel, McKinney, can have a big impact on. And that's one of the reasons why when a crew chief calls a race car driver and says, save me fuel, there's some things he can do inside the car, not just all about killing the motor or anything like that, but there's the way he drives can really make a difference in it. So these are some of the things that Scott Zipadelli and everybody over at Robbie Benton Racing are working on, and it's great to see, family farmers on the side of that car up here in Chicagoland this weekend.
And race fans, if you want to see more of Jeff Hammond tonight, the excitement revs up in Chicago. Things will get wild in the Windy City as the biggest party in racing celebrates the start of the chase. Don't miss next NASCAR Trackside from Chicago tonight at 10:30 Eastern, only on Speed. And Mr. Hammond, I'm sure you can give us a little bit of a preview.
I'm going to tell you right now, it's going to be so funny. I mean, it is. We got David Rudiman on there who got his first, as we like to say, legit win a year ago here at Chicagoland, driving for Michael Waltrip Racing. But the show has got so much personality. I don't want to give away too much, but please tune us in. You will not be disappointed. It'll be worth staying up. Pop that popcorn. Get you a favorite beverage, whether it's water, milk, whatever, to go with popcorn and enjoy the show.
I think it follows the truck race, right?
Yeah, it does.
When I think about trackside, I don't think about water or milk. I think about other beverages.
Well, we got at that time, we want the kids to stay watching, Oreo cookies.
Skim
and
milk
stuff.
Is the thing. Well, one of the three racing Wallaces involved in this race this weekend is Steve Wallace in the number 66. I guess you could say he's taking Daddy's car out for a spin.
And this is a brand new race car they brought here. It's seeing its first laps today. Right now, Steven is 19th. He's run a total of 16 laps. Now, his best finish here in 5 starts is 12th twice, but he did win from the pole in an ARCA race here at Chicagoland back in 2006.
I had a chance to talk to Rusty a few weeks back, and he said that you know, he's impressed with some of the things that are going on within his race teams, but they're just not where they need to be. And it just tells you how tough it really is when they have good drivers like Michael Annette and Steve Wallace behind the wheel, and you have a good owner like Rusty Wallace, who is certainly going to provide them with the best. I mean, heck, he's a past champion in the Cup Series, but it just shows you how tough it is to put it all together.
It really is, John. I don't think we can stress that point enough, that you can put everything together and you can be missing just one minute component. We see it on every level. Guys all of a sudden who are winning or almost winning the year before or the race before, all of a sudden they fall off the edge of the map. What happened? Well, the shot guy left. The aero guy is not the same. They made a change in the geometry to try to make it better. We were interviewing one of the chase contenders, and that was Kevin Harvick. And he was talking about, you know, we won three races real quick and we started experimenting. We wanted to try this, we wanted to try that. Well, they made those changes. They got out of their safety zone. And Larry, you've probably been there before. They couldn't get back to where they started. And they just recently have shown back up the last couple races at RCR and at number 20 in that car, getting like they need to get. So, I mean, everything can change in a blink of an eye.
35 minutes into this practice session, Brad Keselowski still leads the way as Paul Menard, Stenhouse Jr., Carl Edwards, and Trevor Bayne occupy the top five. We'll be back to Chicagoland in a moment.
NASCAR Nationwide Final Practice at Chicagoland Speedway in Joliet, Illinois is underway here. And just wanted to talk about some of the drivers we've been covering on this end in the Nationwide Garage. That's the 7 car of Jamie McMurray, who's in that car for the weekend. Don't be surprised, Danica fans, it's not Danica. And Jamie right now is currently 13th in this practice session, has run about 18 laps. Now, to give you guys at home an update, he has tried several different lines. As you look at his crew chief, Tony Urie Jr. right there, he tried the bottom and he did not like the bottom. He said, man, it gets really tight on the bottom, but he liked the way that the car has been driving. Now, they also tried to run the very top, and he said he hit the sand up there on the top lane and it sounded scary in the car, is how Jamie McMurray described it. But right now, that running in the high line in 1 and 2 seems to be helping Jamie McMurray, but they are definitely moving the car around. They just changed a right rear spring. We're going to see how it affects the car. Randy?
Well, Kevin Conley is in the Conway is in the 87 car here this weekend, trying to make his 7th start. Joe Nemechek, you just stepped in the car a little bit for him to try to figure out if what he was feeling was correct, and what was your assessment?
Well, yeah, Kevin, you know, the Nationwide cars are new to him, especially the COT cars, and our team's growing, building, but he wasn't sure what it was doing, if he should try driving, drive through what he had going on, and I hopped in it, and I'm like, no. I mean, if you try driving through that, you're going to be backed in the fence. So he's got the right feel. We just got to get the car better. And me not being in the Nationwide car this time, I can't give him some input. So he's got the right feel. We just got to make the Extends Toyota better.
Good luck to you. You know, a lot of people may forget about Joe's prowess here, particularly on mile and a half tracks, guys. I mean, this guy is 5th all-time in wins on mile and a half in the Nationwide Series with 8. He definitely can get around this racetrack, so he knows what he's talking about. And don't forget, he's a former champion of this series. So Joe Nemechek trying to help out Kevin in the car.
But that has to make Kevin Conway feel a little better that Joe Nemechek climbed in that car with the credentials just Randy just mentioned, and he's feeling the same thing that Kevin has been describing about that race car.
But sometimes, you know, Larry, you get in a situation where a driver has not run a lot of races. You kind of question how much you should adjust it or how to go about trying to fix the problem. I know that Billy Wilburn's down there working on that car this weekend. And that communication, not working with everybody a whole lot, it can make a big difference. So, yes, it does help when you got the owner and a guy that can get down there and give you that kind of feedback and fix everything.
Now, I wanted to point something out because Wendy Venturini was talking about Jamie McMurray moving up the racetrack. And the one thing that I've been noticing, it seems like the groove has moved higher in 3 and 4 than it has 1 and 2. In 3 and 4, there's almost just about a lane left. But I look in 1 and 2, there's a couple lanes left. So we're definitely seeing it with all the Nationwide Series practice and the 1 Cup practice we've had. We're seeing the groove move a little higher in 3 and 4 than 1 and 2.
But Larry, don't you think that really has to do with this dog leg is kind of in front of this racetrack? The way you need to get down into 1, it kind of makes a driver want to drive it in low. We're entering the turn 3. The transition, we always talk about transitions off into a corner, is a little bit more, I think you'd say, easier. You could float it in there a little bit low and let it kind of slide up, where down in 1 and 2, you really, I think, want to hug that bottom and take advantage of that. You got to check the car up quite a bit.
As we take a good look there at our unstraight back straightaway.
Yeah, it really concerned me in NASCAR Camping World Truck Series qualifying that Michael Waltrip said he hit the wall back there because he tried to go straight one time on the back straightaway. Made me a little concerned. But yes, some drivers said because of that, that of the mile and a half tracks we go to, that the transition into turn three here is a little easier because you are making a turn down the straightaway.
Justin Allgaier has had his share of success on this racetrack, but take a look at this wiggle here, guys.
Yeah, this is Sam Hornish Jr.
Oh,
in the 12 car. And you're carrying so much speed through the middle of the corner with these Nationwide Series cars. And if it bottoms out a little bit or anything, as I see, quite a wiggle right there.
He's got his hands full right now, Larry. And, you know, you hate to say they need to go fix it because they're probably trying to figure out, will it get better? Can I hang on to it? Because with these Nationwide cars, if you tighten them up too much, you kill the speed. These cars do not have the power that the Sprint Cup cars do, pull them up out of the corner. So you need to get in there, let the car roll, stay off the brakes as much as possible, and get back to the throttle as soon as possible.
Now, we were talking about Sam earlier as not having all that much success in the stock cars here, but in the IRL, the Indy Racing League, he has had two victories here at this racetrack. So, again, while it doesn't translate over,
I didn't really say, what does that mean?
Absolutely nothing.
Thank
when it comes
you.
To racing right here.
Yeah, it does.
Brad
he knows where the racetrack is.
He can find the racetrack. He won't be at the wrong track. Brad Keselowski still continues to lead the way in the number 22. We'll be back before final practice in a moment. Monday, NASCAR Race Hub delivers the ultimate recap from Chicago and gets you ready for round two of the chase in New Hampshire. Hear from the drivers and get the latest breaking news and analysis. Don't miss NASCAR Race Hub at its new time, Monday night at 6 p.m. Eastern, only on Speed. We saw one driver earlier in the session run out of fuel. That was Kenny Wallace in the 09. Now, another driver, the 32, Reed Sorensen, has run his car dry as well. Wendy?
Yeah, and it was actually unexpected on this machine. They're actually checking for a fuel pickup problem with Reed Sorensen's car because it started sputtering. He shut it down. The thing is, he had 9 more laps, he was told, before he would run out of fuel. So they were estimating it was about 2 gallons shy from what they were expecting to run out of fuel. So it caught Reed Sorensen way out of sorts. But just to give a little update on the car and the chassis also, with this setup that they're running in this practice session, a little bit more responsive than the earlier practice session. It feels it's pretty good overall. It's a little tick snug in the center, but the lap times are really good. They've only made some small adjustments for Reed Sorensen, but most importantly right now is this fuel pickup problem they really need to fix. Randy?
Well, David Stremme coming off a 13th place run 1 week ago at Richmond, now with the mile and a half. Just talked with these guys down here. Of course, Stremme fairly comfortable in the race car, but it's just a little bit tight. They were going with just a little bit of a bump rubber, just a little bit in the left front shock just moments ago. David went back out on the racetrack, ran it just a couple of laps, not quite happy with it as of right now, but certainly getting this 74 travel car a little bit closer, and certainly they hope to have a good showing here tomorrow, guys.
And Randy, we have a new leader on top of the speed chart right now. It is one of the guys locked in the championship battle. Elliott Sadler in the number 2 car is now the fastest.
But I want to go back to Wendy Ventrini's report on Reed Sorensen. What a blessing that happened to them today. Because if not, it would have caught him off guard in that 300-mile race tomorrow afternoon.
Interesting way the schedule works out this weekend. We have qualifying tomorrow for both top series.
Yeah, we do. And that, to me, is going to be real important. We continue to watch the 32 car, Reed Sorensen and the crew trying to work through it. And guys, I have had this experience in my racing career. I was at Dover one time. I was so mad after that race. We'd gone through inspection, knew we had everything like we needed it. The next thing you know, we're racing here again. We happen to have Andy Peter as a crew chief. We're locked into a mortal battle there. And we know we're gonna beat him. And I'll be a son of a gun. All of a sudden the car ran out of gas. And it was totally unexpected. Got back, had like 2.5 gallons in. But Larry, you remember back to those times. You didn't have the really luxury of these boxes the way the fuel cells are made today. You just had to pick up and you had to kind of keep it pushed down in the corner. It could move around real easy. So that got us in trouble. We didn't do a good enough job checking it out. So they actually have got a huge break because he's not totally out of this championship. He needs to keep it close, and making a mistake like that could really cost him.
Teammate car to the number 7 of Jamie McMurray's Eric Almirola in the number 88, another JR Motorsports entry. He's currently 17th on the chart.
in a lot like the 17, looking for that first win here in 2011, but he finished fourth here in June, and he has three consecutive top 10 finishes, Wendy, including the last 11 races, nine top 10, so they're getting close. Wendy?
The 88 car of Eric Almirola right now is a little bit too tight. They've been working on the bumps. As you look at their lap times, they're 17th in this practice session and have run 18 laps. But it seems like if there's any complaints from a majority of these drivers, it is usually the bumps here at Chicagoland Speedway.
And Wendy, on the left side of your screen, you're looking at Pops, a guy who certainly knows more ins and outs of race cars and racetracks than just about anybody down there.
Let me tell you something. In his day, he could drive a dirt car as good as anybody, and including the late Dale Earnhardt. I remember racing against Pops at Concord, Metrolina, around the Carolinas when I was growing up. He was fierce behind the wheel, knew how to get the job done. He learned a lot. Understanding the relationship between the Earnhardt family and the Urie family goes really deep into Canapolis area.
And apparently pretty good with the wrench as well. Eric Almirola over the years has never really had a chance to sit behind the wheel of one car for any extended period of time. Remember, he was the super sub for Hendrick Motorsports. They were putting him in those cars as a standby. But now he finally has a shot, Larry, at getting some seat time, some consistency with Tony Urie Sr. and now with his team as well.
Well, and I think that's why the goal in these seven races, like a lot of the drivers in the Nationwide Series, is let's get to victory lane. He feels like he's got the opportunity with this 88 team, Dale Earnhardt Jr. and Tony Urie Sr., and they want to capitalize on it.
And if he doesn't get it done, I feel like, you know, there could be some pressure on this young man. Yeah, it's a winning race car, got to get to victory lane.
About 25 minutes left to go in this session. Elliott Sadler leads the way after 18 laps out on the racetrack. Brad Keselowski is second, and it's Allgaier, Edwards, and Paul Menard rounding out your top five. Welcome back, everyone, to Nationwide Series final practice. Sunday, NASCAR race day breezes into Chicago as the chase begins. Kyle Busch, Jimmy Johnson, and Carl Edwards join us live. Plus, don't miss an exclusive performance by Darius Rucker. NASCAR race day built by the Home Depot Sunday at 11 Eastern live on Speed. Right now, the number 20 car being piloted by Ryan Truex is 14th fastest on the chart.
Now, there's an interesting story with this young man. It has to do with the Rookie of the Year points battle. Now, he has only run 12 races, and he is scheduled to be in this 20 car four more races, including Chicagoland. Timmy Hill leads the Rookie of the Year points by 43 points over Ryan Truex, also Blake Koch and Jennifer Jo Cobb. But the way the Rookie of the Year points are calculated is on your 16 best finishes. And when you have a finish like he had at Richmond last week of finishing fourth, that gets you a lot of points because there's a lot of bonus points that goes on your Rookie of the Year points when you finish in the top 10. I think someone did the math. When he ran those 10 races for Michael Waltrip Racing in the beginning of the year and they elected to do six races with Joe Gibbs Racing, that's 16 races. Don't count him out to win this Rookie of the Year.
The math works out, and as far as we can understand, that is a temporary deal with Joe Gibbs Racing just for the six races. He doesn't necessarily know where he's going to be next year.
No, but it gives him an opportunity to showcase his talent in a really good race car. They've got, you know, the funding they need to get it, keep it going. It keeps Joe's drivers focused doing what?
Trying to win a cup championship.
Trying to win a cup championship. So it serves two purposes here, and you're bringing along the next generation of talent that we expect to come down the pike here. So it's a win-win for everybody all the way around. And what a big boost in your career if you can come out of this season, run Timmy Hill down, and win Rookie of the Year.
And it's also one of those good news, bad news situations for a driver like that. Okay, first of all, here's the good news. You're driving a Joe Gibbs Toyota. Here's the bad news. You're driving a Joe Gibbs Toyota. You better do well behind the wheel of it.
If you can't stand the heat in the kitchen, brother, get out. I mean, that's exactly what you get into when you come to NASCAR. I mean, you've got to step up. You've got to produce. And that, to me, that's what it's all about. Taking a look right now, Mike Wallace right now currently 12th in points right now. He gained one spot up as far as last week from Richmond. Decent finish.
Well, there's the young man I was talking about, Timmy Hill, who is leading the NASCAR Nationwide Series Rookie of the Year points battle. But he has 26 races under his belt. He did not run the Daytona 500 because he was not old enough. He didn't turn 18 till the week after the Daytona 500. But now you're not going to see him accumulate a lot more points unless he betters a finish from his best 16 finishes because he's run so many races so far.
That is Jermaine Racing Car with Bobby Burrell as the crew chief. And remember him, he's a crew member back for Ward Burton, the number 22, back in the day. And it was his injury that made us put helmets on pit road guys, if you
That's
remember
right.
that incident. So Bobby Burrell been around for a long time. Let's go back down to the garage and check in with Randy.
Yeah, just talking to the guys on the another 11 of Joe Gibbs Racing. Brian Scott behind the wheel. You know, he's had a pretty solid last two or three months. As a matter of fact, last weekend, of course, at Richmond, not a good night there. Finished 32nd after getting in a wreck, but he did put together 14 straight races with the worst finish of a 17th. Now sits 10th in points. But this practice session, guys, has not been good. Since the moment they went out there in this practice session, Brian's been complaining about a vibration. They do not know where it's coming from. Right now, the guys are underneath. They're changing the rear gear and hoping that perhaps it's in the rear gear. But of course, as you well know, it could be anywhere in that drivetrain. They're just trying to narrow it down. So not a good scenario for these guys in the final practice session of Nationwide.
Well, the real problem, they only have 20 minutes to find it. That's how long we have left in this practice session.
The Beach Boys sung of good vibrations. There's no such thing in a race car.
No,
all
sir.
Vibrations
and
are bad.
They normally don't go away, because if you think they'll go away on their own, the next thing you hear will be the crew chief of the spotter saying, are you okay? Will it crank?
Two wins over his career for Justin Allgaier, and if I'm not mistaken, one of those wins came right here at Chicagoland.
Back in June.
Elliott Sadler continues to lead the way on top of the speed chart right now. And you guys, Sadler is on a roll, leads all drivers in points earned over the last six races. So that's a good time of year to be on a positive roll.
Well, he said all along, you know, just give me an opportunity to win this championship and I will go get it. And he and Ernie Cope right now, they're putting it together. They're working out some of the problems, some of the issues. But Larry, you know this, they've been able to cut that deficit down from points, as far as points, from 29 points down to where it is now at 16, but they gave some valuable points back at Richmond. Even though they had a top 10 finish, Ricky Stenhouse finished third, I think it was, in the race that night. So they can't allow that. They got to flip-flop it so they can really take some big chunks out and get more of a head-to-head competition going together against each other over these final seven races.
What concerns me, I'm seeing some of the same thing that we saw at the last mile-and-a-half racetrack, which was Atlanta a couple weeks ago. Those Roush Fenway Fords, right now they're fourth, sixth, and seventh. They're looking pretty strong.
You know, we always say if you're in it, you can win it. Justin Allgaier led only the final lap when he won here in June after a Roush Fenway car, Carl Edwards, ran out of fuel.
I think he even ran out of fuel.
NASCAR Nationwide Series final practice from Joliet, Illinois is about an hour old with about 15 minutes left to go. As we take a look at the number six car being piloted by Ricky Stenhouse, let's take a look at the points as they run right now with seven races to go. It's Stenhouse with a 16-point lead over Elliott Sadler. Reed Sorensen still has a possibility to factor in this thing, as does Eric Almirola and Justin Allgaier, albeit those would be long shots. As of right now, though, Ricky Stenhouse Jr. isn't paying attention to points. He's paying attention to the action on the racetrack.
Well, I think if you look at it over the whole season, no matter where you are in points, you just got to go out there and get all the points you can. I mean, you just got to go out there. You don't have to really worry about the points. You just go do the best job that you can do. I don't think you can really technically points race until at Homestead when you know exactly what you need. The way our series has been this year, you know, whoever's leading always tends to have a bad race and brings everybody right back into it. It doesn't matter if you're 70 or 80 points out of it, come Homestead, you could be in the still. So we just got to stay consistent. And I think if we run the way we've been running the last few weeks, that we can do that. And, you know, we just plan on staying up front as much as we can. It seems, you know, if you can stay in the top five, you know, tend to stay out of trouble up there. And that's really our game plan from here on out.
Well, John, I tell you right now, he's got the right idea, but he needs to put one other thing in there. Don't beat yourself. Don't take a race car that may be a top five race car and try to go win a race unless it's a winning race car. You've got to be smart enough. And that's where maybe Elliott Sadler's experience may be the difference as far as who winds up winning this championship. If they can keep him calm and Mike Kelly can get in his head and make him understand that you go drive off in that corner to try to beat a Brad Keselowski or even your teammate Carl Edwards. You know, so you know you got the second best car, but you're going to prove to him I got the best car, and you wreck it, who loses here? You lose everything them guys work for. You've got to keep control of this young man because he's in excellent position right now, and you know he's forcing Elliott to come to him. Just got to not beat yourself.
But that's what I love about this new point system, just like we did in Sprint Cup. There's not a lot of mathematics involved because right now, 16 points. Now, I know we have the bonus points for leading the lap and 3 points for winning, but at the end of the day, 16 points is 16 positions. Elliott Sadler knows if Ernie Cope after the race says, you finish second and Ricky Stenhouse Jr. finishes 18th, they know for the most part, okay, we're tied now with six races to go because of the way the point system is.
I like it too because those 3 years of ninth grade, I never was too good in that, man.
Yeah, not from not. No.
Let's go to Wendy Venturini for more. Wendy?
Oh, goodness. I don't know if I can add to that. Ricky Stenhouse Jr. had four laps on this set of tires that he just ran. He's fourth in this practice session. His feedback just now on that last run said that he felt like they're missing it on their mile-and-a-half tracks in qualifying trim lately. So that's where they feel like they're struggling. The run before that, though, I just want to give an update on his race trim and when they had 45-lap tires on the car. It was too tight in 3 and 4 in the entry in 1 and 2. He said he could feel it in the steering wheel like the tires were about to give out. And Mike Kelly's crew chief said, yep, that's the way it should feel at the end of a run, and especially with as many laps as they had on those tires. So they're learning a lot in this practice session. Randy?
I'm going to try and get a word with Jeremy Clements here. Jeremy has really been doing an outstanding job in practice, let alone last week at Richmond, a terrific run. Now, this kid looking at race 27, you know, for quite a long time, he only had two finishes on the lead lap. All of a sudden, two straight finishes, a 14th and a 14th, goes to show you what you can do when you can keep the car out there all day.
Yeah, I mean, we just had bad luck earlier in the season, you know, stuff falling off and breaking all the time, and we finally able to get it going in the right direction. And for a small team running every week, that's what's been the burden, just getting the cars to the track. But we've turned around, and I feel good about our car in the long run today. We've got tires from the last race here, so we haven't put the new tires on to support our troops. And I think once we put those on, we'll bust off a good lap. But we're not going to worry about that. We got it set up for the race, and that's what we're here for. Wherever we qualify, and we got a special logo on the hood to the Defenders for Children from Spartanburg and Greenville, South Carolina. We're racing for them and my my cousin Antonia that died from cancer at 34. We're racing for her and them this weekend, so we're going to get a good run again, get another top 15, hopefully top 10.
Good luck in your continued improvement here in the series. You know, let's not forget, this guy's being coached down here by Ricky Pearson. For all you longtime fans, of course, brother of Larry Pearson, a two-time Busch Series, now Nationwide Series championship driver, Ricky Pearson. A lot of those wins have come in this series, so Ricky certainly knows how to coach this young man. Guys.
Randy, thanks a lot. That's, of course, part of that Spartanburg, South Carolina connection. Right now, Jeremy Clements in the 51 is 25th on the speed chart. Elliott Sadler continues to lead the way, and time is running down. Speed's presentation of NASCAR Nationwide Series practice from Chicagoland is brought to you by your Honda dealer. Little less than 10 minutes left in this final practice session for the Nationwide Series, and we are at Chicagoland Speedway in Joliet, Illinois. As we see, the campers are out here in full force, and so are the fans. That's an Italian Ferrari flag.
It is.
That's good. Shows people love their automobiles anywhere.
Hey, racers, it don't make any difference. I love all forms of motorsports.
Yep, exactly. And here in the NASCAR Nationwide Series, we can put together both Italy with Emporia, Virginia, and Emporia, Kansas, for that matter.
We can. Bogota, Colombia. Yeah. We got it all covered.
We got it all covered.
Australia.
Jason Leffler's trying to pick up a little bit of speed. He's got the 19th position currently covered. And while we were away just a moment ago, a guy who busted off a lap was Eric Almirola in the number 88 car.
Yeah, Jason Leffler, who comes in here sixth in the points, very vocal this past week that he is searching for a ride in 2012. It does not look like he will be back at Turner Motorsports.
And Left Turn Leffler, certainly one of the veterans of this sport, spent some time in the Cup Series, spent a lot of time in the Nationwide Series.
Before this practice is over, I do want to say this, JR. You've been promoing trackside and NASCAR race day built by the Home Depot and Speed Center.
The here one it comes. Thing that, here it
no,
comes.
No, the one thing that I am happy about, because you know what? When ESPN takes the races over, I'm at home and I'm a fan. Is NASCAR Victory Lane that you, Kenny Wallace, and Kyle Petty do, it now will basically essentially follow the broadcast of the race. I think that is so cool. So we want to make sure our viewers know that you guys will be coming on not long after the race is over.
Yeah, and the thing we love about that show is everybody on that show is happy. The winner is happy because he won the race. The owner's happy because he won the race. And the rest of us are happy because we just don't know any better. Jennifer Jo Cobb, currently 46th.
You get caught up in the heat of the moment. I mean, it really is. I've done that show with you, John. I love it because, again, you feel like you're part of that whole celebration, and it's quite an experience. And I'm glad we're, you know, able to kind of like, you know, bring it to the fans immediately after the race and what's going on. And nobody has to sit there and wait for it till 8 o'clock on Eastern and watch it. You know, we can have it right then.
We're seeing Michael Annette here in the 62 car. We were about to tell this story earlier when Kenny Wallace ran out of fuel. We talk about a lot of the pit crew members that were professional athletes. I just found out this week that Michael is a former ice hockey defenseman for Team Illinois. He actually led them to the 2002 Calgary Max AAA Hockey Tournament Championship, and then he joined the U.S. Hockey League, the Waterloo Blackhawks in Iowa, which is his home state, and they won the championship that year as well. So here's a man from professional hockey turned professional race car driver.
So he also then skates very hard for the organization, you know?
I would think so. And you know, of course, we know that Paul Menard actually races on ice during the offseason.
Let's go to Randy.
Well, we got Scott Wimmer down here, just climbed out of the 81 car. Six-time winner in this series. Scott, you're trying to continue to rekindle your Nationwide Series career. Give me a sense of how this car is and what you might expect here tomorrow.
It's not too bad. I got to thank Randy McDonald for letting me do this. And, you know, it's a tough way coming with a lot of underfunded teams and things like that. But we've got this car running pretty good. I got to thank Kay Love for coming aboard. And, you know, if we get out of here with top 15, I'll be pretty excited with that.
A lot of people wondering what Kay Love is.
K-Love, a radio station. They're all over the nation, 94.3 up here in Chicago. But I want to thank them. They're a great sponsor, and hopefully we can put a good show on for them.
All right, Scott, a lot of people pulling for this young man. You know, one of the better talents down here for sure, just has really been struggling here in the last couple of years, guys.
Scott Wimmer is going to be making his 225th Nationwide Series start this weekend. And you know what? We're glad to see a little love on the racetrack. We need some more love. Right now, Elliott Sadler's getting it. He's P1. Only a couple moments left in Nationwide Series practice, but tonight on Speed, we are still chock full. NASCAR Sprint Cup final practice comes your way at 6 o'clock Eastern Time. Then the Camping World Truck Series setup show, presented by Polaris, is at 7:30 Eastern Time. And then, of course, the Fast 5 225 is at 8 o'clock Eastern Time. 13 trucks set new track records in qualifying, so it is going to be interesting to see what happens on the track. And then, of course, trackside is always interesting. Mr. Hammond promises that you will laugh if you watch trackside. Then Speed Center wraps everything up with Adam Alexander at 11:30 Eastern Time. Less than 3 minutes left to go as Elliott Sadler leads the way. And there's the 12th car of Sam Hornes Jr. trying to get some last-minute work in here.
Now, we hadn't mentioned the fact that we've got a pretty good field of cars here, 48 cars. Sam Hornes Jr. is a go-or-go homer, but he's 12th quickest. The fastest go-or-go homer, Trevor Bayne in the 16. He is third. But the five drivers, if this was qualifying, that would not make the show would be Mike Carmen, Jennifer Jo Cobb, Tim Andrews, Brian Keselowski, and Matt Carter. That's the five slowest of our go-or-go homers. That's actually the five slowest drivers in the field of this practice.
And, Larry, you know, the thing that's kind of funny about this is that we come back around 11 o'clock in the morning and got to go out there and qualify. And a lot of these guys have an opportunity to do a lot of soul searching to try to find that extra speed so they can make this race. But one guy looks like he's got enough speed right now is Trevor Bayne. Randy?
Yeah, thanks, Jeff, doing double duty here this weekend. Your speed's pretty good in the Nationwide car. How does this correspond from one to the other? Is it helping you here this weekend at all?
You know, I think it did at first when I stepped in the Cup car. I had never been here in a Cup car before. So coming right out of the Nationwide series where we were really fast, it helped me get up to speed on the Cup side where we were fifth in the first practice. And our number 16 Ford Mustang over here has been fast today as well. So it's a good weekend at Chicago. I really like this track. And hopefully we can either get a win with our RickyVerseTrevor.com Ford or our Ford Motorcraft and Quick Lane Ford over there this weekend. But we're just looking for a couple top 10 finishes and you know, I'm still looking for that first win, though, in the Nationwide car, and I think this could be the weekend. It's pretty good.
He seems jacked up. He's got a run right now, heading over to the Cup Garage. Of course, once again, doing double duty. Wendy?
Thanks, Randy. Eric on the rollout. We'll end up second in this practice session, but Eric, it's quite a change because you worked a lot on this race car and a little bit happier now, it sounds like.
Yeah, we are a lot happier with our Swapman Chevrolet right now. We struggled. We've been struggling all day, just like everybody, going across the bumps in 3 and 4. And I think it's going to be about who gets it the best. I don't think anybody's going to get it perfect, but who fights it the least. And we made some adjustments right there towards the end of practice, and Pop's got the car a lot better. We still don't have it quite exactly where we want it, but it's a lot better. And that was a nice qualifying lap. Drove pretty good right there, so that got us up on the board. But in race trim, we still need a little bit to be where we want to be, but we're a lot better than where we started, and all the guys have been working really hard. So hopefully we'll get it just a little bit better, and we'll race these guys tomorrow for a win.
All right, good luck to Eric tomorrow. But it's been a lot of work here on the 88 team during these two practice sessions. Johnny.
And you know, Wendy, for Eric Almirola, stats are in his favor. 4 of the 11 Chicagoland races in the Nationwide Series, Larry, have been won by first-time winners. So this could be the one for Eric if you look at statistically.
While we're speaking of winners, here's a trivia question. We've had 11 Nationwide Series races here.
Yep.
We've had 9 different winners. Is this practice coming to a close?
Over.
Who won that very first race in 2001 here in the Nationwide Series?
Joe Nemechek.
No, it was actually Jimmy Johnson who got his only career Nationwide Series win.
That is right, for the Herzogs.
Herzogs, number 92.
That is right. Well, that was a good thing. I was way off with Nemechek, wasn't I?
Well, they're both Sprint Cup Series drivers.
Let's take a look at the final speeds from this final practice. Elliott Sadler, Eric Almirola, Trevor Bain, Paul Menard, and Brad Keselowski are in your top 5. And, of course, Ricky Stenhouse Jr. dropped down a little bit to 8th on the chart, but nonetheless, those are the two guys you really got to keep an eye on in this points battle.
Well, and we mentioned Justin Allgaier. He won the race here in June, so keep a watch on him as well.
So Elliott Sadler leads the way a little bit better than 177 miles per hour. He has been the guy who has been on a roll lately.
Got to get in their head when you can, and right now he's got a fast race car.
Well, this practice is over, and time is running out on the championship battle in the Nationwide Series. But right now, we're going to go to Chris Devoda and Hermie Sadler.
Welcome back to Chicagoland Speedway, Nationwide Series final practice, the second of two practices here at the track today. Just wrapping up, there you see a lot of the teams, team owners, Jack Roush standing by, checking things out. Again, Nationwide Series will qualify tomorrow. A busy day here at the track. Welcome back to the speed stage, Chris Devoda. And a lot of guys up front in the first practice, Ryan Truex, Trevor Bain, different names up front in this practice. We'll get to that in just a minute. But first, let's go ahead and take a look at what's left here on our Friday menu on speed. As we said, a very busy day indeed. We still have Sprint Cup Series final practice, the second of their two practices. And then the trucks take the track. We have the Truck Series setup and the race, the Fast 5 225. Still to come, a triple header weekend, then trackside presented by Walmart and Speed Center, wrapping up with a very late edition. Wow, if you have had your television on speed, you have seen just about everything today. Welcome back again to the speed stage. Hermie Sadler joining me now. We have a great crowd on hand. A little bit chilly here in Chicagoland, but we enjoy these cool temperatures because, as you so eloquently said, when the temperatures dip, the speeds
go up. And, it, you know, temperature does make a difference in a lot of respects for the drivers. You know, not only how they feel inside the car and those kind of things, but the tires, how they hook up, and the characteristics of the racetrack are a lot different than they were when the Nationwide Series cars were here, you know, earlier this year for a night race. It was a lot warmer than in July. So a lot of variables this weekend, and therefore we see some different people up front on the speed charts.
Well, we mentioned Ryan Truex was quickest in the first practice. Let's go ahead and take a look at this Happy Hour Nationwide final practice. There you see the 22. Brad Keselowski, he was really quick. No surprise to see him quick again.
Yeah, no question about it. And Brad is getting back in this Nationwide Series car after taking some time off with his injury. I know he loves driving this car. Look for him to be very fast here tomorrow. It's Paul Menard right there driving that 33 car out of KHI State. He was fourth fastest in this practice. A little extra seat time this weekend. He's also pretty good in his cup car as well, Crystal.
Yeah, we've seen consistency. Like we said, he was quick in that first practice. So was this guy, the 16 of Trevor Bain. Trevor Bain was fourth quick in the first practice, jumps up to third quick here in happy hour. So again, as you said, when guys sort of hit on something, they've been pretty consistent throughout the day today.
This 88 car right here, we've been waiting for this car too. to get up front and have a chance to win some races. Eric Almirola in his 88 car, Virginia Motorsports, second fastest in this final practice.
Yeah, and they've been really consistent in the points. So like you said, we've just been waiting to see them do something in some of these races. Could be a win on hand for Eric Almirola. You never know. But again, hey, look at familiar face, familiar name up top here in happy hour.
Yeah, Elliott Sadler, he's fastest in final practice now. He finished 11th here last time, but he was leading with about 10 or 15 laps to go and cut a right front tire. And I had a chance to eat dinner with Elliott last night, and he said, you know what, we really need to win a race. We could have won this race last time, and they feel like they got a great chance to get this number two car to victory lane.
Well, in Joliet, just outside Chicago, it's all about the Blues Brothers, so no surprise to see the Sadler Brothers dominating things today. Let's head down back inside the garage where Ray Dunlap is standing by with another driver.
Well, thank you, Christy. You know, when we went to Daytona back in February, they asked me to handicap the championship this year, and I went with the 88 of Eric Almirola. I figured he was going to have a good shot, or Elliott Sadler. Those were my two favorite picks. I didn't put this guy on the list, but I'll tell you what, I may have screwed up, because the most pleasant surprise of this season has got to be Kenny Wallace and the 09 team. You guys have been right there in the top five week in and week out. Kenny, what has been the difference with you and this team this season?
Thank you, Ray. Well, it's been a lot of hard work. I mean, you know, drove around during the wintertime trying to find money so I can get with a competitive team. So I found Robbie Benton, RAB Racing with Brack Maggart. We got hooked up with, Toyota Factory backing, Triad Motors, new tires every week, and Scott Zippidelli, my crew chief. I'm just with a way more competitive team. And then I told the guys, I said, if we can come back the second time, you know, all new teams are like, well, we should be better the second time around, and we are. So we've finished better every time we've gone back to the second go-round. So I'm excited. You know, sponsors like Family Farmers, you know, I represent the farmers. I want to give a shout-out to the farmers. It's harvest season. They're bringing in their crops right now. And, I mean, that, what I just said, is a key to why I'm running better this year. Money buys speed.
Yeah, I got that. Okay, how about a mile and a half? Tell us about this track here. What's your chances?
Well, they're a lot better now than they've ever been in my career. Everybody knows I'm running good on the short tracks. I've had some good friends, like my past car owner, Andy Petrie, called me up after Vegas, and he said, Herm, that's really impressive. You're running way better on the mile and a half now. And I said, thank you, Andy. So some of my friends, you know, that know that I struggle on the mile and a half, so know how hard I've worked on it. So, we run six here the last race, and we're just trying to do better.
And they're right there, Chris, in the top 10 so far in practice here at Chicago.
Thanks, Ray. Yeah, they are certainly riding momentum. And let's take a look, speaking of momentum, at the guys leading the point standings. Ricky Stenhouse, Hermie, he has sort of stretched out his lead a little bit over your brother.
Yeah, Ricky Stenhouse Jr., what a great job he's done. A turnaround season for him that has turned into, Krista, a chance to win a championship. It looks like Roush Fenway against the experience of KHI and Elliott Sadler so far.
And I think keep your eye on Justin Allgaier in this race tomorrow. He won this race last year, and he is definitely hungry for some respect and some redemption this season. The only changes in that top 10 list, by the way, since last week, Michael Annette and Brian Scott flip-flopping positions. And we are just getting started. Sprint Cup Series final practice still to come. We will preview things here from the speed stage. Stick around. We are just getting warmed up in a chilly Chicagoland. Welcome back to NASCAR Live here on Speed. Nationwide Series final practice just wrapping up. A lot of familiar names up top. Elliott Sadler pacing happy hour. Next up is Sprint Cup Series final practice. As we said, a very busy day here on Speed here at Chicagoland Speedway. And speaking of the Sprint Cup drivers, let's take a look at some fun numbers. These are the chasers, the guys in the chase, and their average finish at this track. What do you think about this, Hermie?
Well, you see Jeff Gordon average finish 8.6. That's the best number. Tony Stewart inside of a top 10 finish. You know, Crystal, but I'm not real sure these numbers always mean a whole lot to me. Each season takes on its own momentum, and remember 4 or 5 weeks ago we looked at Brad Keselowski's stats at upcoming tracks, and they were all awful, and he went on a tremendous tear to get back in this championship hunt. So it certainly means something for us to talk about, but I'm not sure it means a whole lot to the guys that are actually on the racetrack.
Okay, so I'm going to sum up what you said. Don't look at the numbers as much as you look at momentum.
Look at what they're doing right now is more important than their career numbers, in my opinion.
Okay, theories according to Hermie Sadler. We like it. Let's get back inside in the garage. Ray Dunlap has caught up with someone else.
Well, Chris, actually, I'm just standing around down here as we get ready to go back to practice. But what I found very interesting, listening to the drivers in the media center today, everyone was saying that they're approaching this chase as a dogfight. yeah, there's 12 drivers in this chase, but they truly believe that there are at least 8 different drivers that could win this championship this year. And when we look at the cars that are in this garage, beautiful equipment. But here's what I found interesting. When I talked to multiple different crew chiefs down here, all of them told me they have at least 10 different cars prepared and ready to go racing in the chase. Normally, you would think that you would see these guys use the same car at Phoenix that they would use at Loudoun. Many of them will take the car that they race here and possibly repurpose it. But the bottom line here is, if you need to, each and every one of these teams are ready to go compete with 10 different cars for 10 different races. That shows you how important winning a championship in the Spring Cup Series really is.
And we hear the cars firing up behind your race, so we know practice is under or about to be underway. And this is some more fun numbers, Hermie. Check this out. This is the average finish at the chase tracks of this year, the places we've raced this year. So we don't count Chicago or Homestead because we haven't been there.
Yeah, that's very interesting numbers. Look at Kyle Busch. Average finish of 17.5, which does go back to the point that Kyle Busch has, you know, historically struggled in the chase. He'll have to get those numbers turned around to be a factor for this championship.
And that's our points leader with the worst average in these tracks. And look at who has the best. I think the fans will be happy to hear that Dale Earnhardt Jr. has had the best average finish at the chase tracks we've been to this year.
Well, but go back to what we just talked about. He's got the best average finish for this, but so far his momentum in the second half of the season has not been what he's going to need to contend for the championship. We'll see if he can get it turned around.
Well, speaking of momentum, at least what we've seen on the track today with our first Sprint Cup practice, David Ruderman was the fastest. David Ruderman won this race last year here at Chicago.
You know, the only way you're going to get a lot of exposure if you're not a chase driver is to win a race. David Ruderman did that last year. Looks like he's got his eyes on trying to do it again.
Yeah, a couple different agendas inside the garage. And speaking of inside the garage, Ray, do you have anyone else?
Well, Chris, I just wanted to give you a final thought as we get done with this program. When you look over here, Kevin Harvick getting ready to jump in his car. Very, very calm. I'll tell you what, he's got a lot of confidence, especially at this racetrack. He and Kyle Busch coming into this chase, both with 4 wins coming in. I think the confidence factor right here in Team 29 is going to be one that you're going to have to beat.
Absolutely. Kevin Harvick, a former winner at this track. We mentioned Tony Stewart, very good here at Chicago. Who else do you like?
Well, you know, Kyle Busch, he's the real wild card. And Brad Keselowski, he's kind of new to this whole championship mix. We'll see.